Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Parkinson's Society Southwestern Ontario's April Awareness Webinar. Today, we're very fortunate to have someone that is associated with PSSO joining us, and it's really nice to see the kind of the fruits of our collective labors here in having Mike join us. So Mike completed your bachelor's degree in neuroscience at U of T, of U of Toronto. And then you have a master's in pathology from Western. Really cool. So you worked on uncovering cellular mechanisms, alpha-synuclein interferes with to cause toxicity. I messed that up brutally.
Oh, I did very well.
Now, this is where we come in. For the work, you were awarded one of our graduate scholarships. Now, what year was that? A few years ago?
That was 2018, April 11th. So almost 4 years to the day, actually.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. And then as a consequence, you did more work and you've now founded the startup Relup, which uses artificial intelligence to create diagnostics for neurodegenerative disorders. So I understand about a third of that, which I'm hoping you're going to explain the rest of it during your session. So I've got a few more people joining us, but I'm going to turn control over to you and mute myself, and please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. So let me just optimize video clip that appropriately. Okay, so thank you very much, Mark, for that introduction, and thank you to Shelley and everyone else at the PSSO, and thank you for everyone else in attendance, actually, for joining this talk here. I'm very, very happy to be here. So, I'm going to get into this, the role of AI in diagnosing and monitoring Parkinson's. Before I really jump into it, though, I think I want to just briefly go over the main reasons for having this webinar, what the objectives are. So the singular greatest purpose is really to recruit participants for our study, where we'll be using AI to detect Parkinson's. So if this does still seem a little bit unclear what that exactly entails, that's okay, because I plan on using the majority of this talk to really just give some background information on artificial intelligence and explaining what it is, how AI, which is artificial intelligence, is used in medicine, how it's being applied in Parkinson's research, how we at Relup are leveraging artificial intelligence to this end, what this study entails and why it matters, and most importantly, how you can participate in this study that we're going to be working on. So I think the first order of business will be to define what AI or artificial intelligence is. So simply put, AI is the capacity of computers or other machines to exhibit or simulate intelligent behavior. Now, I'm sure many of you have had experience interacting with AI in various forms. For example, if you've ever used Google Translate to maybe understand how to say good night in Spanish or something, that would be using artificial intelligence. If you've ever have an iPhone, and if you've asked a Siri a question, Siri is going to be using AI to both understand what you're saying and then give you the correct answer. Many of you might have used Netflix before. So if Netflix has ever recommended a movie or a show for you to watch based on the other shows you've watched, so something which you will likely enjoy watching, that is done using AI. So those are some more simple examples of AI in use. Some famous feats of AI would be, back in 1997, IBM's Deep Blue, a supercomputer, beat the chess grandmaster Garry Kasparov. And that was the first time that a computer system using AI was able to beat a chess grandmaster. Then more recently, in 2017, AlphaGo, another AI model, beat the world's best human at the game called Go. If anybody has a Tesla or has heard of Tesla, you might be aware that their autopilot or self-driving feature is really quite extraordinary, and how it's able to stay in lanes. It's able to slow down and speed up when there are objects or cars in the way. And this is all done via artificial intelligence. Now, sometimes when people hear the term AI, they start thinking of machines and robots taking over the world and enslaving humans. Now, I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon, but to show how AI can be used in robotics in a more lighthearted way, I've included a little video here, which, it might terrify you just how incredible it is, but hopefully it provides some ease to that end. So just briefly, and please let me know if the sound is not working. You broke my heart, 'cause I couldn't dance. You didn't even want me around. And now I'm back to let you know I can really shake them down.
Okay, everybody, sorry about that. It looks like Mike's video got him booted. He'll be right back online in just a second. Don't we love technology? Just give it a sec. Sorry about that. Did anybody else find that dog a little creepy? Sorry, I'm just waiting for him to sign back in, and we'll move it ahead again. You are on mute, everybody, just so you know, so it's a little easier on the Zoom for Mike to be able to speak with everybody and share his presentation in case there's any extraneous noises. So we'll just leave that on mute for the time being. Waiting for him to sign back in.
Power went off in my building. There we go. It's back on now.
There you go.
Okay. Yeah, my apologies for that again. Just lost Wi-Fi for a couple minutes there.
Then by the time it resets.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
All right. I'm going to mute myself. Go ahead, Mike.
Okay, great. I'll jump back in. So there we go. Oh, sorry. Share screen. Okay. Okay, so again, sorry about that. So where we were before was I was showing you these incredible robots using AI. So I've given you a few examples of AI and what it's able to do. But I guess the question is, if you look under the hood, what is AI really composed of? So it can be thought of as a combination of math and logic rules. Now, the type of AI that we are interested in is called machine learning. And as the name suggests, with machine learning, it is a program which is able to improve itself using algorithms. So what exactly are algorithms? An algorithm is a set of instructions used to solve a problem or perform a computation. So for example, x equals 1 would be an equation. It's just simply x equals 1. However, the rules for long division would be an algorithm. Another example of this could be if you wanted to bake a pie, the ingredients that you would be using to bake, let's say, an apple pie would be like the equations, whereas the algorithm would be the instructions to put these ingredients in the right places in the right order to then bake the pie. So the ingredients are the equations, and the instructions would be the algorithm. So I can give another simple example of how you can use AI in practice and how it would look. So suppose you wanted to predict the prices of a house based on the size of the house or the square footage. So we have some examples here of the square feet on the left column and price on the right. And we can see 1,000 square foot house costs, let's say $100,000, 2,000 square foot house costs $200,000, and so on. Now, I'm sure many of you can already see the general trend here, but to make this visualization easier, let's plot these values where we will have square feet on the x-axis and we will have price on the y-axis. Suppose you then wanted to predict the price of a house based off a square footage of right here, the size of a house that falls right there. I'm sure many of you can intuit what you would want to do is draw a line of best fit through these dots here up to that point. And wherever the square footage intersects that point, you would find the price. Now, a computer program, unfortunately, cannot just intuit how to draw a line of best fit. What a computer needs to do is it needs to rely on algorithms and instructions. So how do we then create algorithms to write this line of best fit for a computer? How can a computer do that on its own? Well, if you might recall from, I think, grade school, maybe high school, the equation of a line probably used linear regression, and you were taught y equals mx plus b. To flip the m upside down and call it a w. So our equation for a line will be y equals wx plus b. Y is the price of the house that we want to predict. X is the square footage. And W is called the weight. And B is called the bias. So now, how do we use this linear regression equation in an algorithm? How do we get a computer to figure out the correct W and B for predicting house prices? What we would do is we would add what's called the cost function and gradient descent. So here's our equation here, y equals wx plus b. The cost function will tell you how close or far your estimates, your y value, are from the correct price. Gradient descent will then change the weight and the bias values to make the predictions closer to the correct prices. So if, for example, your predictions are too high, gradient descent would then say, okay, your predictions are too high, so let's make the W smaller and the B smaller so that our Y becomes smaller. And then we're hopefully closer to the correct value that we wanted to predict. So if a house cost $200,000 and you said your Y value was $300,000, then you would make the W smaller and the B smaller until you got closer and closer and closer to $200,000. So what would that look like? When this artificial intelligence is starting with y equals wx plus b equation, it's going to initiate the w and the b value randomly. So let's say it selects 0 and 80,000, and that's its first line of best fit. That would look like this line right here. Your cost function would then say, okay, Here's how large of an error you've made in predicting this value. Here's how large of an error you've made in predicting this value, and so on and so on. Gradient descent would then say, all right, we're continually predicting too low of a value for the real values up here. So what we need to do is increase the size of W and increase the size of B. Maybe it'll be Y equals 1X plus 85,000. And it will continue to do that until the line gets bigger and bigger and bigger and ends up fitting in much more nicely with these points here, like so. And then you'll see the cost function is now much smaller. And now our line of best fit is much more accurate and is much closer to all the real values. And then we could say at this point here, a house of this size will cost, there's our line, approximately that much. So to show what this would look like in action when a computer using AI is doing this, you can look at this illustration here where at first the line starts off, you know, way off, it's not accurate at all, but then the cost function and gradient descent are increasing the W and the B so that it gets closer and closer and closer to what the line of best fit really should be in a perfect scenario. And at that point, we can finish our AI training. It's good enough as is. So that was a very basic example of how AI can be used to create this AI to predict housing prices using square foot. A slightly more complex scenario, Mark was telling us about his dog earlier, is using image classification from artificial intelligence. So here's an example of an artificial intelligence model being shown images of different breeds of dogs and cats, and it's telling you what type of dog or cat that is. So we see we have a Great Pyrenees right here. We have a Chihuahua, when showed a picture of a Chihuahua. I'm not sure what an Egyptian Mao is, but I will take the AI at its word and assume it's gotten that one correct. Now, this is a relatively not a very profound task that AI is being applied to, but this AI of image classification can be applied to what I think are much more interesting endeavors. For example, AI has become really useful in cancer detection. So there are various mobile applications which use AI to detect whether a growth on someone's skin is cancerous or not. So here we have an example of an app being used where someone will take a picture of a growth that they have on their skin, and the AI model that is within the mobile application will tell that person whether they think it's cancer or not. On the right, we can see two radiographs, and on the right side of this picture on the right, we see the AI is showing us an area of interest that it thinks it has identified cancer in. Now, in radiology, AI has really been quite exciting. And what's been found is that in some cases, AI models can detect cancer sometimes much more accurately than a radiologist would. And what's also very interesting about this is that an AI program or model might be able to look at, you know, over 1,000 images and make predictions in about, you know, a few seconds, whereas a radiologist would take a considerable amount of time to look and to spot the signs of cancer for just a single image. So AI has the potential to be not only more accurate, but much more efficient in doing things like cancer detection using images. AI has also been a boon to drug discovery. So oftentimes when you're trying to create a new drug for a disorder or disease, the effectiveness of this drug will depend on how it interacts with a protein target. So the interaction of the drug and the protein depends a lot on the shape of the protein. So it's often very useful to know what the shape of your protein target is to know how your drug will affect this protein. Now, it used to be very difficult to determine the shape of a protein. I actually had a friend who was had to do this for part of his graduate degree, and he was often lamenting about it because it took so long and it was very complex. So thankfully, nowadays, we have certain forms of AI which can actually predict the shape of a protein only by knowing its amino acid sequence. So the amino acid sequence is basically the ingredients of the protein. So that's like being able to predict the shape of IKEA furniture just from seeing all the unassembled parts laid out on the floor in no correct order. So if anyone has any experience trying to assemble IKEA furniture, you know just how difficult that can be, even when you have the owner's manual. So if you're able to do that just by seeing unassembled parts on the ground, you can imagine how really quite impactful that can be. So there are other ways actually that AI is also used in drug discovery, and perhaps we can get into more details in that later, but this is just a quick intro. Moving on, how has AI been used in neurodegenerative diseases? So one way is, again, using image classification, as we showed with the dogs and with the images of radiographs. There are certain AI models which are able to detect Alzheimer's disease at over 99% accuracy by being shown brain images of people with and without Alzheimer's disease. There are also certain cognitive tests which have been put on mobile applications, as illustrated below, and an individual's performance on these tests over time can be indicative of whether that person is aging in a healthy way or if they're having some cognitive deficits, which are perhaps indicative of a neurodegenerative disorder like Alzheimer's or dementia. Further, as we see on the right here, speech has also been shown promise as a potential indicator of neurodegenerative disorders. So AI can use the way somebody is speaking and recording of someone's voice to determine whether they have something like dementia or Parkinson's or perhaps ALS. Now, one of the takeaway messages here is that data is power. So while AI has led to advancements in various fields, it requires a lot of data for optimal performance. So if we look back to that example where we had an AI image classifier that was classifying the breed of a dog or a cat, if you wanted that AI classification model to become close to 100% accurate, you might need to show it well over 100,000 images of dogs and cats before it trains enough and becomes good enough to get very high levels of accuracy. There are certain models like the Netflix, for example, or Siri, where they will be using millions of examples of images or recordings in order to get as accurate as they currently are. Now, that's great for those purposes, but when it gets to medical applications, the issue is that medical data sets are generally quite expensive and very difficult to curate, and therefore they tend to be much smaller. And the trend is the larger, the more data you have, the more powerful and more accurate your AI will be. So there are certain techniques that can enable one to have success on small data sets. Yet, generally speaking, it's always better to just create larger data sets to collect more data, and that will lead to a much more powerful AI. So this brings us to my startup, ReLoop, and what we are doing. So we're focused on leveraging artificial intelligence to create diagnostics and softwares for neurodegenerative diseases such as Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, CTE, and also concussion. So what have we done so far? On the right, you don't have to read it all. I'll give you the details in a second. It's just a screenshot of a preprint for a publication we're currently submitting. We were the first to show that using AI, one can accurately predict whether an individual has a history of repetitive head impacts or repetitive head injuries, such as those you would incur through football or perhaps boxing or mixed martial arts. So using a single 13-second voice clip, we are able to detect a history of repetitive head impacts at 85% accuracy. We're able to detect Alzheimer's at 88% accuracy and Parkinson's at 89% accuracy. So to put these numbers in context, the previous best results for Alzheimer's detection was 81.9%. And for Parkinson's, it was 84, we achieved 89%. So these improvements are due to our own methods and techniques that we're using. So some of the collaborations we're working on, we're working with researchers at the UHN, the University of Toronto, and the Mila Institute on a study using artificial intelligence to detect and diagnose concussion. We're also working with researchers at Boston University, the Framingham Heart Study, Harvard, and again, the Mila Institute to use artificial intelligence to detect Alzheimer's disease and related dementias. And finally, what the point of this conversation or this webinar is about is introducing the study where we'll be using artificial intelligence to detect and diagnose Parkinson's disease. So I know this is a very educated audience when it comes to Parkinson's, so I won't spend too much time telling you things you already know, but briefly, I'll just give a quick intro. Parkinson's is the second most common neurodegenerative disorder, which affects roughly 1% of the population over 60. Some of the symptoms include resting tremor, rigidness, difficulty initiating movement, and speech disturbances. It's also not uncommon to have cognitive impairments as well. Now, most of these behavioral symptoms are due to the neurodegeneration of dopaminergic neurons or brain cells in the pars compacta of the substantia nigra. So I mentioned that Parkinson's disease is known for its motor symptoms. And while it is a movement disorder, it does also present often with non-motor symptoms. So standard neuropsychological tests have revealed difficulties with memory, language, executive functioning, and visuospatial skills. Many of these impairments occur in the early stages of Parkinson's, and they might often present before movement difficulties. So if I went over that quickly, that's not to worry about, because I'm going to go into a little bit more detail in the next few slides. So I mentioned executive functioning. So first, I'll just give a quick intro on what it is. It can be thought of as the skills required for planning, organizing, paying attention, and inhibiting the wrong types of behavior. A way of thinking of what executive functioning is it's basically what you develop, what changes from when someone is an adolescent to when they become an adult. So if you're, you know, a 16-year-old who's driving way too fast and is not completing homework and never on time and disorganized, and then all of a sudden the mature, hopefully adult, will be driving the speed limit and not like a maniac, and they become much more organized, and they're not always rebelling and doing perhaps less than ideal activities. That's basically because you're developing executive functioning. So in Parkinson's, sometimes there are deficits in executive functioning, such as initiating or sustaining and shifting cognitive sets and other issues. So shifting cognitive sets, just to give a quick description, that could be like if you're playing a game and someone instructs you to raise your left hand every time you hear the word blue. And then they say, okay, now I want you to raise your left hand every time you hear the word green. But if someone continues to raise their left hand when they hear the word blue, they're having difficulty with shifting. So these deficits are generally observable within the first 2 years of diagnosis. So they tend to happen relatively early on in disease progression. And this is thought to be due to dopamine depletion extending to the frontal lobes. Okay, another thing I mentioned is visuospatial skills. Now, as the name suggests, this is basically understanding of visual and spatial relationships amongst objects. So it would be looking at, two towers in the distance, perhaps, and seeing which one is taller, or assessing how much coffee you can fit inside a mug, whether one mug is able to fit more coffee than the other. Now, in Parkinson's, deficits in visuospatial skills can sometimes predict future development of dementia, and your visual spatial skills might also be able to predict the effectiveness of deep brain stimulation surgery. It's also been found that performance on these skills decline with Parkinson's, which means that it seems to be intimately linked to disease progression. Finally, I touched on memory, and some memory impairments have been found in Parkinson's, specifically with recall, immediate recall, clustering strategies, and interference effects. So I'll just give a touch on those really briefly. Immediate recall is if somebody says, here are five numbers, please give those back to me right now. You have to immediately recall those five numbers. Clustering strategies would be if someone said, remember these next five words, banana, apple, orange, monkey, chimpanzee, gorilla. A clustering strategy would be to say, okay, three of those were fruits and three of those were mammals. Those would be clustering strategies. And interference effects is if somebody says, remember these first three things, and then they ask you to remember another set of things, the second set might interfere with your memory of the first set. So that's considered an interference effect. Now, what's somewhat interesting with Parkinson's is that it seems that these memory deficits might in fact be due to difficulties with planning, sequencing, and organizing information during the encoding of the memory, as opposed to difficulties with the memory faculties themselves. So for example, in Alzheimer's, what tends to happen is somebody has an area of the brain responsible for encoding memories that is not functioning properly. And so they're not able to store those memories properly anymore. With Parkinson's disease, they actually do still have those areas of the brain still functioning properly and able to encode those memories. They're just having difficulty packaging the memories and getting them into that storage facility. So how does one diagnose Parkinson's? There are a few different methods. Generally, it's based on patient's history, patient's symptoms, and some neurological tests. The gold standard for diagnoses are the Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale, the HY Staging Scale. Now, unfortunately, diagnosing Parkinson's is not a walk in the park. There is still no single objective test to diagnose Parkinson's, as there may be to, you know, detect a broken bone, for example. You take an x-ray, you see a fracture, and we know the bone is broken. Unfortunately, that's not the case in Parkinson's. It's not as simple. Diagnoses are clinical, and there is a certain amount of subjectivity involved. In fact, up to around 30% of Parkinson's diagnoses are misdiagnosed, especially during the early stages. So this means that oftentimes other diseases that might present similarly or might look similar to Parkinson's can be confused with Parkinson's, such as Alzheimer's or essential tremor. With regards to the gold standards, the UPDRS, it appears better at identifying moderate to severe and not as good at identifying early stage Parkinson's. Now, the HY staging scale largely ignores the non-motor aspects of Parkinson's. And as we were just talking about memory and executive functioning, visual spatial skills, the non-motor aspects can be quite significant. So why do effective diagnoses matter so much? There are a few reasons. One is that an early diagnosis can enable individuals to begin treatment and to plan ahead to how they would like to live with Parkinson's. Misdiagnoses also are not good because if you have Parkinson's, but you're diagnosed as having something else, number one, you're not going to be given the treatment for Parkinson's. Number two, you'll likely be given treatment for another disorder, and that might, in fact, make the symptoms of Parkinson's even worse, and vice versa. Further, sufficiently early diagnoses could facilitate research of preventative measures. So what that means is if you were able to diagnose Parkinson's 10 years before any symptoms occurred, at that point, development of therapeutics would not be focused on ameliorating or making the symptoms of Parkinson's better. What they would be focused on would be preventing the symptoms from ever occurring. Further, diagnosing Parkinson's accurately and capturing the full umbrella of symptoms can help with researching therapeutics and cures. So I'm going to unpackage that a little bit more in the next two slides, I think. So how exactly do diagnostics, as I was saying, help with the research? Well, when you're studying the effectiveness of likely a drug therapy, one will need objective indicators of how well the therapy is working. And some of these indicators are better than others. For example, you know, it might not be enough to have a new Parkinson's drug and just ask someone, you know, do you feel better or worse? That might not be enough. What ideally you want are indicators that are objective, meaning nobody has to kind of guesstimate whether they think you look better or not. You want them dose dependent, meaning more of the therapy leads to more of the thing you're measuring, and less of the therapy leads to less of the thing you're measuring. And ideally, you would like to capture the full spectrum of the disease. So if you're only focusing on motor symptoms, maybe your motor symptoms are getting better, but perhaps the cognitive symptoms are getting much worse, or perhaps they're just unaffected. It'd be something you'd like to be aware of. Now, these indicators oftentimes come in the form of what are called biomarkers. So biomarkers are objective, quantifiable indicators of health or disease. So a simple example would be blood sugar level is an example of a biomarker that would be useful in diabetes research. suppose you have a new drug you want to test to see how effective it is for diabetes. If you're measuring blood sugar levels, and you can tell when you use this drug, are they normal range? Are they low? Are they high? If they're high or low, your drug is not working. If they're normal, your drug is working. Now, digital biomarkers are simply biomarkers that are collected via digital devices. So digital biomarkers effectively be used to measure how well a potential Parkinson's therapy is working, or Parkinson's drug. Their advantage over traditional biomarkers is that they are non-invasive, meaning they don't require the extraction of blood or bodily fluids, and they're quite expedient, meaning they're normally quite fast to take. So to summarize, currently with Parkinson's disease diagnoses, accurate as we would like them to be, and sometimes they are confused, or other disorders are confused for Parkinson's and vice versa. There's often a degree of subjectivity involved in the evaluations, and in some of the gold standard assessments, they're not characterizing the full range of Parkinson's symptoms. If, however, we were able to establish certain digital biomarkers of Parkinson's, we would likely be able to increase the diagnostic accuracy and therefore reduce the likelihood of misdiagnoses. We'd also be able to eliminate the subjectivity, so no one would have to be, you know, guesstimating whether one is doing better or worse, or does or doesn't have a disease. You'd be able to better characterize the full range of Parkinson's symptoms, and it would be a very powerful tool for researching new therapeutics for Parkinson's. So how can we at ReLoop help, for example? What can we bring to the table? Well, what we're trying to do with this study is we're trying to utilize artificial intelligence to investigate digital biomarkers of Parkinson's disease. Now, how can AI, as you are all now relatively familiar with, detect Parkinson's? So one thing which we touched on was that speech has shown promise as a potential biomarker of Parkinson's. So we've used a single 13-second voice clip to detect Parkinson's at 89% accuracy. Further, we talked about smartphone applications from, you know, iPhone or Android, which are able to implement standard cognitive tests, which would before be used via pen and paper. So what this means is you're now able to have a smartphone application which can not only assess cognitive skills, but because it's using a touchpad and you're using your finger to interact with the smartphone, it's also able to assess fine motor control and coordination. So therefore, in this study, which we're proposing, we will be combining speech, motor tests, and cognitive tests to detect Parkinson's. So what will this study entail? It will include a 1-minute voice recording, 5 cognitive assessments, and all this will be mediated through a smartphone application. It should take approximately 15 minutes for completion. So we're hoping this will be quite expedient. So what will this create? What will this look like when it's all said and done? So right now, if a doctor has somebody presenting with symptoms which seem like they might be from a neurodegenerative disorder, he might not be sure which neurodegenerative disorder it is. Maybe, so we see here, they're mostly cognitive functions. So we see on the left, these are motor features, on the right, cognitive features. So perhaps this individual is displaying mostly cognitive features. And this one has a mix more of cognitive and motor features. This one is motor features with some cognitive features. This one is mostly motor with some cognitive features as well. It might be difficult to tell, is this early stage Parkinson's? Is this CTE? It's late stage Alzheimer's? What we are trying to do is to use the same assessment, the same toolkit using AI to get a idea of what these various neurodegenerative disorders look like with this assessment. And so then you'll have a more clear view of the distribution of features. So it'll be easier now to say, okay, this is what Parkinson's looks like. This is what Parkinson's with cognitive impairment looks like, and CTE, et cetera. So what we were hoping will come from that is we'll be able to eliminate the subjectivity in diagnoses. So no one will have to be more or less estimating what they think somebody has. We'll also be reducing the likelihood of Parkinson's being misdiagnosed as another condition, because we'll be able to separate the features much more clearly, the profile of features. We'll also be able to decrease the time required to make a diagnosis and also increase accuracy. Further, providing digital biomarkers will allow researchers to use them when they're working on therapeutics and cures. They'll be able to get objective feedback of how their potential therapy is improving the lives of those with Parkinson's. Lastly, what we really want to do, as I mentioned, data is power, and the larger data set you have, the better your AI model will be. We want to create a large Parkinson's disease data set. So how can you help with this? The most important thing to do would be to participate. And way of participating, it's been posted on the PSSO website under research and then research opportunities. And then you should see the ability to click on our study and fill out a form. And then we'll get in touch with you regarding next steps. So with I'd like to thank everyone in attendance. Thank you, Mark and Shelley and everyone at the PSSO. So there we go. April 11th, 2018. so almost 4 to the day. And I'm happy to take any questions you might have at this time.
Yeah, what we're going to do, folks, thank you, Mike, first of all. What we're going to do is open the floor up, and you are all muted, so you'll just need to unmute yourself to ask a question. I'm going to ask the first question, though, Mike. I've been kind of listening and preparing, and I'm wondering if specifically thinking about people that are already diagnosed with PD, is this a test that potentially could be used for the next generation, for their kids or grandkids, to ineffectively, identify the markers that they may or may not have PD or CTE in the future?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. And that's what we're trying to do actually with our work in Alzheimer's disease. With the Framingham Heart Study, what they have is it's a longitudinal study where they've been tracking people throughout their lifetime. So that means you have data on people when they're 20 years old and completely healthy, 30, 40, and then as they start showing certain signs of certain diseases and disorders. So that's absolutely something that we would love to do. What that entails, though, is collecting data on people before they are diagnosed with the disease. So if if somebody, let's say, has a family history of Parkinson's, or if they have familial form, then using these assessments on them, before they develop any clinically relevant symptoms is how we'd exactly be able to do that. And then you would have a tool where you can say, okay, it's likely the case that unless we intervene, in 10 years you might develop symptoms, or in 15 years you might develop symptoms.
Okay, yeah. I'm opening the floor. If anybody would like to unmute themselves and ask Mike a question, please feel free to. I'm watching the mics on the side here, but I'll ask the second question then in the meantime. Basically, what are the next steps to make this the diagnostic tool for the future? So where do we go next? Where does ReLoop go that it takes it then to the next step of maybe getting it into a physician's hands or a neurologist's hands?
Yeah, so there are a few different steps. The first thing is we have to collect the data, right? We have to collect the data, use this cognitive tool, see what the results are, and then we analyze it using artificial intelligence. We're also going to want to publish these results in peer-reviewed journals so that other perhaps neurologists and researchers can see what we've done and give us their input. The first thing that it could be used as with basically minimal red tape would be as a screening tool. So this would mean that a clinician would be able to use it when he suspects somebody may or may not have a disease. And then you could say, okay, based off, your medical history, my expertise as a medical doctor, and what this tool says, we think you have X, Y, or Z, or you don't. To be an official diagnostic tool, you would need it to be actually approved by the regulatory agencies of wherever it is that you're applying for, FDA or Canada or Europe, etc. But generally, what you need to get approval is you need evidence of the tool's effectiveness. And that's where the studies come in. First, you show that it is effective. You are able to diagnose X, Y, and Z at these levels of accuracy. And then hopefully they become approved. And then clinicians can use that as the standard practice.
And how long do you think that's going to take realistically in you know, today's world?
So again, there are different steps. The screening can be quite quick. If you want to use it as a screening tool, basically, as soon as you're done the study, you can more or less send it to a doctor and they can use it as a screening tool. For regulation, it takes a little more time. I would imagine within a couple of years, you know, maybe 3 years, perhaps. It depends, but I should note actually that both the Canadian and the American regulatory systems are actually creating expedited routes for these types of digital AI types of tools. So it used to be a much more rigorous and time-consuming and bureaucratic process to go through, but they are actively actually improving that and making it possible to bring these into practice at a much faster time. So maybe it takes 3 years now, but within a couple months, maybe it'll only take 6 months or something.
Okay. And in terms of benchmarking the disease itself, when you view a video clip or when you go through the AI process, does it kind of benchmark where it feel like where it, you are in the process or where you are in the disease progression?
Yeah, so it all depends on how you'd like to set it up, what you would like it to do. It certainly can do that. So you could set it up so that it is say 1, 2, 3, 4. The most simple way would be yes or no. What you need for this to be possible is you need people in each of those stages, right? So you need the data. So if you have people with early stage, middle stage, late stage, if you have people who have a history of Parkinson's, but they haven't developed it themselves, then you'll be able to start to get, as we talked about before, the ability to predict future outcomes. So it's really up to the data that you have. And the more data you have, the more representative your data is of the full spectrum of Parkinson's, the better your AI model will be and the more it'll be able to do. Excellent. If that makes sense.
Yeah. Cam, I see you've taken your mic off. Are you up for a question?
I am. Well, I have a question and just a general comment. Mike, that's a fantastic presentation. The work you're doing is really, really impressive. That's fantastic. I do have a question in terms of the study and the participants you're looking for. Ideally, how many study participants do you need?
So how many we need and how many would like? Bit of a different okay, sure. So we've had success using basically 50 healthy controls and 50 with Parkinson's, so 100 in total. However, the more you have, the better your AI will be. So you know, if we could get everyone in Canada involved, that would be ideal, right? I think the minimum amount is probably 100 people, but again, it's going to be much better and much more powerful if we can get hundreds of people or thousands of people involved.
Okay.
Yeah, I can kind of explain why if you'd like, it's.
Well, it's interesting. I can understand the more the merrier.
Right.
I guess,
yeah.
I guess. And so you answered one of my questions. So you want people that have Parkinson's, and then you want another group that doesn't have Parkinson's as well to participate.
Exactly. Okay. So, so this is a kind of relevant to the way that a lot of these medical studies have been done before AI became so prevalent. And sometimes they are still unfortunately done this way. What people used to do and still do sometimes is they perform statistical analyses on whatever it is they're studying. So let's say you want to determine whether resting tremors is something that you can use to identify people with Parkinson's or without. If you're using a statistical analysis, you want to see whether measurements in two groups are statistically significant, right? If you remember p-values, that kind of stuff. So what you'll do is you might collect 20 people or 25 people with Parkinson's and then 5 people without, and measure, you know, maybe how much or how little their hand is moving, and then say, okay, you know, here's the average score for the Parkinson's people. Here's the average score for the healthy controls. are they statistically significant? And you'll get, you know, yes or no. For predictive models, like what AI is all about, it's about making predictions, not just saying, are these different? So for that, you want as many people in both groups. So you want an even distribution. And you also want it to be, again, the more people, the more slight differences you also start to uncover, right? So if, let's say, for example, maybe if you're using a study of only 20 people with Parkinson's, maybe all of them are, you know, above 70, or maybe all of them are in their 60s. But we know that Parkinson's can affect people anywhere from some cases like 40 up until the 90s or above. So if you're using a small sample size, your AI model might be very good at predicting people only who are 60 years old, right? Or in their 60s. So the more representative your sample is of the general Parkinson's population, the better your AI model will be. If that helps explain.
Yes, thank you very much. And as far as participants go, is there a way for people to participate remotely?
Absolutely. Yeah. So it would require the use of a smartphone, so either an Android or an iPhone.
Okay.
I think I was speaking to Shelly about this very briefly, but if people don't have a smartphone, I think we can figure out how to do that. We can probably provide a smartphone and then maybe, you know, use one of the hubs, perhaps in London or something, as a place where people can come in and use it. But it would, definitely be remotely accessible.
And one final question for me, just the name of your company, ReLoop, what's the backdrop, the context for the name?
Right. So a couple of things. There is a function in artificial intelligence, some of the equations. I wonder if I could actually find, I think I had it in one of my slides. It's called a rectified linear activation unit, and it's shortened as ReLU or ReLU. And then a loop is something in computer programming, and computer programming is what you use to run these AI algorithms and models. And then I just thought, you know, ReLoop is kind of an amalgamation of the ReLU activation unit, which was fundamental, basically led to a big breakthrough in AI, and loop is computer programming, and re is like redoing something. So I'm thinking of, you know, rethinking like medicine and AI together. And that's where my background comes from too. It's also supposed to be basically a representation of a neuron kind of stimulating itself. So it's kind of like artificial intelligence is improving itself. So
got it. Yeah. I love the name. Yeah, that's all my questions. And I'll just say thanks again. You're an excellent presenter, and I love the work that you're doing.
Thank you very much. I very much appreciate that. Thank you.
Thanks, Kim. Does anybody else have any questions before we wrap up? The floor is open. Not seeing any mics coming off or any hands going up, but okay, barring that, Mike, thank you so much. I mean, this was a great presentation. And Kim actually stole my last question. I was going to ask you about the ReLoop, how that came into be. Oh, Diane and Lloyd actually have unmuted. I'm guessing you have a question.
Yeah, well, we just wanted to say thank you. It was an amazing presentation. Yeah. Good. Wow, the work you're doing, it blows our mind. We've got to think about it.
Thank you.
But yeah, we'll be up more. And oh, wow, wonderful, wonderful stuff. And great questions, Mark and Kim. Great questions. Answered all ours. Yeah. And thank we you. Do really have concerns that. With our, we have two younger sons and two sons, and we're just, you know, concerned about them someday, maybe them developing Parkinson's. Mm-hmm. So the study information is quite interesting.
Well, maybe they could participate in the study.
For sure. That'd be great.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
That was great. As I said, Mike, thank you so much. You know, it's especially appropriate as this is Parkinson's Awareness Month. You know, that we're able to start looking towards the future. I know we sometimes get caught up in that thing where nothing has been moving forward for so long, but it's just not true. I mean, we've got so much moving forward, and we can look to the future and the diagnoses and the medications that are coming, and you know, we can look at finally kind of kicking this disease in the butt a little bit and yeah. You know, making life so much better for those that have it and that are living with it. So thank you so much on behalf of all of us here at PSSO, at Parkinson's Society Southwestern Ontario. I do want to remind everybody that our next educational opportunity is just a few weeks away in Walkerton, Ontario, for our spring conference. It's going to be a great, great selection of speakers, including Dr. Tiago Mestre, Dr. Galit Kleiner, Dr. Mandar Jog, Dr. Brian Young, and a nurse practitioner that's local that's going to be speaking on advocacy named Lauren Gardner. So it's not too late to register. We still have virtual and a few, although the in-person spots are filling up. If you'd like to register, please join us at psso.ca. Thank you to all of you for participating and asking my questions and keep challenging us to bring you the speakers that you want to hear from and that you want you know to represent. So my final comment is, if you like programs like this, if you like our webinars, we get supported by you. So we don't receive that government support. We receive very limited government support in certain cases. So if you enjoy things like that, become a monthly donor, or you know, use that little tax refund that's coming back to help out PSSO by making a donation online. So thank you to everyone for joining us. Mike, again, great presentation. Thank you for your enthusiasm and the work you're doing. And everyone, celebrate Parkinson's Awareness Month. You know, like the poster in the background says, we love somebody with Parkinson's. And make sure everybody knows it. Have a great day, everyone. Take care.
Okay. Thank you very much. Take care.